Excited about that because there's something much more exciting going on.
Clean.
All right, never mind. Oh.
Nessa.
Okay.
We're fucking damned. It was more like Nessa. Oh my god, Declan, you have no idea how much I love love.
What? Okay, but how do you like? I need to know your stance on all the major emotions. All
right, give me pick something from the spectrum of emotions.
Spite.
Love it.
Oh, all right. What about Schadenfreude?
Oh, I love that.
Yeah.
Not as much as I love love, but I still really. I love it.
What about What about frustration?
That's like my second favorite. Speaking of frustration,
did you see Star Wars?
No.
Oh,
is it more? Wait, I don't know. I don't want to know anything. I don't want to know anything about it. Have you been reading it? Reading stuff about it?
Yeah. Who cares?
Well, I gotta see it.
Oh god.
But I can't bring somebody else's opinion into the movie with me.
I thought we'd given up. What happened?
Whoa, No. I said no. We gave up if the new one is just episode 5.
Oh, come on. That's just, I thought you were cool, man.
Nah, man. They got me. Dude, you should see my room. It's full of Porg dolls right now. It's just my bed is littered with them. I think they're going to be worth something someday.
You're supposed to throw them out. You're supposed to throw them out after you use them once. You can't really clean them out very well. They grow mold, you know.
I've been selling my soiled Porg dolls on the internet for a profit.
You pretend they're teenage girls and they just go for gangbusters.
Oh, very lucrative. Star Wars and teenage girl, like forget about it.
The internet
loves both those things equally.
So you don't even want to know how people feel about it?
No.
Fuck. All right.
We'll give you once I've seen it.
Next time.
Yeah.
Aw.
We can't be too topical. We have to be 2 weeks late on everything.
It's a good thing I didn't, because I was going to do this podcast from the road in my car again, and you didn't want me to, and I was upset because I was going to go to the movie theater and just look at people going inside to see Star Wars.
Yeah, no. I wanted to do it right. Nah. Oh, my boy, in place.
Those are the fun episodes.
Rock steady.
I forget if I did that once or twice. I think only once.
All right, how do people feel about the new Star Wars? Fuck.
It's mixed, but what was funniest was when the dudes in my office, one of which is 100% normie, and one of which is a total... he would listen to what the nerd crew is making fun of, right? Just standard nerd guy.
Yeah.
Both are just shitting on this movie all day. They fucking hate it so much. It was amazing. He even understood that the Porgs were a marketing gimmick for kids. They're breaking the conditioning. The normies are busting through.
Fool me once. Shame on you. Fool me twice.
Shame on me. This is a guy who likes Attack of the Clones. He fucking hates this movie already. And he's
wow. I mean, whoa, it's impossible. so he's just, you cannot take his opinion at face value.
I don't know.
I think it might just be, I think everybody's contrarian to a fault now. Yeah, I guess that's not contrarian if they both agree that it's shit. Did he like? You need to get his opinion on Rogue One, and then we can kind of gauge to what, you know, like what, where he's coming from, like what we can use that as a barometer.
Maybe, I don't know. I didn't see that that shit.
You made the right call. It's a snooze fest
according,
for sure. I wanted
to about half of people. Yes,
I wanted to leave. I was like, no, this is bad. But you know, Rogue One and Fractale have a
lot of similarities. A
lot of similarities.
How many similarities does Fractale have with Samurai Flamenco?
Well, one of them is a masterpiece that will live on throughout time, mm-hmm. and the other is a 11 episode long cock tease train wreck.
Yeah, I decided we would watch Fractale because it's important.
Mm-hmm.
It's got it's culturally of value,
culturally significant. They're gonna put it in the Smithsonian.
It's going in a museum.
Uh huh. It belongs in a museum. Yeah.
And that's why it's going. Where did I put my notes? Shit. Oh, they're there. Yeah, I just finished watching this. I got some stuff to say about Fractale.
Boy, do I, as well. I also just finished watching this. How many minutes ago did you finish the final episode?
About 15.
Ascend into the sun.
The second significant, very deeply significant, meaningful seagull shot. The first of which is the first shot of the show, and the second of which
is
the last
freedom.
Shot.
It's about freedom.
Oh, isn't it always?
It's like poetry.
Isn't it just always about birds and freedoms?
I also finished this 15 minutes ago. I almost want to start from the back, the end, and work our way backwards with this.
That'd be a weird way to go about it. I don't know why you want to do that.
Just because it's so fresh in my mind of like the last episode in particular, kind of, I would say, is probably the worst episode of the show.
Yeah.
Because you already know that it's not going to resolve in a way that is satisfying, because you can just tell,
absolutely,
like, wow, there's nowhere near enough time left in the show to resolve this. And the ending is way worse than I possibly could have imagined, and like really obtuse and it just highlights the worst aspects of the show.
Imagine taking Code Geass's ending and like dividing it by 100,000.
Yeah. This show has no sort of like the pacing is just utterly abysmal, and you just end up in places like the final episode of the show could take place fucking anywhere. Like, there's just no grounding at all.
There's no grounding there in space.
I know, but like where the fuck, like, this is, there's been no inclination of like, this is where we're headed at all. Like, what is this temple going to be? And then there's this fucking elevator into space, and yep. it just the world continues to be basically a complete fucking mystery. Like, this show spends a lot of its time like trying to convince you that this world
has
character or exists, and they do nothing to do that. Like,
nope.
The rules are horribly explained, and oftentimes not explained, and like the locations are seemingly completely random, and like, oh god,
you're 100% right, but we have to start at the beginning.
Okay.
We have to lay some ground rules of our own, lest we make the same mistakes as Fractale.
Sure. Because we just ended up at the end there.
Exactly.
The audience has no idea how we got there.
No, that's the hook.
Oh, God, I'm falling into the trap.
Now we got to draw them in.
Okay.
2011.
Uh-huh.
I just barely missed the show. I started watching right after. This aired the same season as Madoka. original show from A1 and Ordette. But most importantly, it's directed by a certain man, a certain fellow.
Uh-oh.
Named Yutaka Yamamoto, also known as Yamakan, our good friend Yamakan. And Yamakan has gotten a little bit of a He's a bit of a character. People know him. He started out working on a bunch of 2000s era KyoAni stuff. He directed Kanagi and the first four episodes of Lucky Star. And he was fired from Lucky Star or removed or something because it was too boring. He was following the manga too closely. You know KyoAni, they like to shake it up. So he apparently resolved to drop tons of acid and save anime by imitating Ghibli a lot.
Really poorly.
Very, very poorly. And he has been mocked for this a little bit because he didn't save a damn thing, as the image macros point out. So,
oh god, it's fuck me up.
So like, he made this, and then he made Wake Up Girls, which had an okay movie, followed by, as I've noted many times before on this very podcast, one of the worst series I've ever finished. And then after he finished those two shows, he whined like a bitch on Twitter a lot when he didn't get season two of that show. And he's also known for lamenting. He's one of the when I say imitating Ghibli, I don't just mean the animation. He also laments otakuism, and he cheers whenever the industry branches out, so to speak, by appealing to the normal, wider crowds, the normies. And he, he's that guy. Enthusiasts in pretty much any medium will be familiar with this type of person. The person I hate the most in this world.
He succeeded in making a show that is so general and so broad as to appeal to all audiences that it's completely characterless, and it's impossible to be offended by it because it is devoid of anything of note. And goddamn, we gotta get started on the show. I need to talk about this bullshit.
Yeah, but it's a good background. Just like, this guy hates otaku. He probably hates any kind of exclusive community or club because he cannot take any rejection, and he can't handle criticism, and he's desperate for mainstream approval, which is completely pathetic, really.
Making things for approval from other people is always a recipe for success, as we've learned.
Yes, he wants to destroy any specialized sort of culture-rich groups for the sake of normalcy and inclusion, and then he's failed to make anything memorable again and again, and then he declared anime dead according to this Anime News Network article from 2016.
Stop the presses.
Yeah, it's dead. Stop again.
The irate animator declares anime dead.
I did find a funny interview from him in 2009. He's at an American anime convention, and it's right in the middle of Endless Eight, and someone just asks him why, and he had left KyoAni like a year before that, and he was just like, yeah, they were floating that idea around, and I, not to toot my own horn, but I was against it, so he at least has that going for him. And then in 2010 he said he'll retire if Fractale does poorly. And then what else did he do? He predicted the end of anime after Kanagi's poor home video sales. That was in what, 2008, 2009?
This guy seems like a fucking good time at a party, man. This is this guy's he's a hoot.
This guy is always falling in Yamakan's world. There's another really good interview from Japanator 2009, which I guess is a Destructoid sister site, which is really weird because There was a controversy in Kanagi where, like, he made the main girl. He has this weird thing with deflowering girls, which we'll see in Fractale. But there was a controversy around that in Kanagi, and this Destructoid sister site in 2009, the interview dude just straight up asks him if the Kanagi girl is a virgin, which is, they had balls back then. Jesus. Impressive. He doesn't answer, of course, but hey.
He should have said, fuck no. He should have, like, laid it on strong. He should have stuck to his guns.
Fractale. Then we begin Fractale.
Yes.
I started the first one, and I was very drunk. And were you also drunk? I need to know.
Oh yeah.
So I'll have no way of knowing, because I feel like this show starts out okay.
No. I'm in the exact same boat as you, where I started this show very drunk, and I'm like, this has put, like, I'm like, well, it's attempting the Ghibli thing. It's not 100% reaching it, but it's like, oh, it's a television show. I'll cut it some slack. Maybe these ideas will blossom in some way that's you know, satisfying.
I wasn't that optimistic, but our main character is Klain, and he lives in a little cottage on like a cliff in a bunch of grass fields, and I'm watching. UTW did these subs, and this is from 2011. UTW, these subs are garbage, absolute trash. I guess they didn't start out very good. Meals are getting taken instead of eaten, and someone says, I've stopped doing a thing 5 years ago instead of I stopped. This is not how you talk. Anyways, you learn very quickly that this show has no sense of aesthetic because there's all just these silly creatures walking around. It's like Summer Wars, but just in real life, in Ireland or something. There's just all these crazy things with no coherency to their design walking around, and they call them doppels, like doppelganger. And I still don't even understand if they're people or if they're like people's avatars or what the hell's going on. Do you have any idea?
So the doppels aren't really explained adequately. No. I don't, because we meet. So one of, you know, he's got his mother and his father who have doppels that represent them in the house. But like, and they, you know, they have that family dynamic. But we meet his father later, who is nothing. I assume you've seen the show if you're listening to this. We meet his dad, and he's absolutely nothing like his doppel at all. So are they sentient? Are they independently sentient, or are they controlled by the people who have the doppel? What's the deal, man?
Yeah, I'm watching this first episode. I'm like, wait, are his parents dead, and these are people live forever in the Asdoppels, or are his parents off vacation somewhere, and these are just like AIs that are trained on them to act like them? It just doesn't go into it at all.
Yeah, it never is explained. And also, we have a character in, you know, like our trio, of main characters who is a doppel, but exists in a, has a physical form, kind of, in a way that other doppels don't. And this is just the beginning of the series having, like, introducing ideas that are never explained or developed upon, or, you know, like, it just floats these concepts and you anticipate some sort of resolution to them, but no, never. Ever. Nope. Never, never, ever, ever. They're just there for effect.
What I do like is they got data narcotics. They got computer drugs, and that comes up like twice. They should just do that the whole time. That should be the whole show. Doing data.
Yeah, because then we would get actual fractals in our show. We could get some actual psychedelia. Well, you know, other than just inside the opening.
Yeah, the opening is just a bunch of fractals. And I'm, first of all, I wonder if they just had to make the fractals for the last scene of the show, and then it was really expensive, so they just made it the opening. But also, I'm kind of surprised Japan can't just, like, arrest whoever is responsible for this opening, because they've clearly just done drugs. It's like they made a minute and a half long thing just saying, like, hey, I've done drugs before. Come get me. And they don't think anything...
They're pretty good fractals. They're really, really, really
the way
nice
they
fractals.
Swim around it. Whoever made this, they've gotten around. They've been seen in the streets.
I think the worst part. So the opening's great. Like I'm totally about the opening.
Do you like the music? It's like this shitty entheogenic. Like.
Yeah, I did like the music. I'm. It's just a pleasant thing to wash over me while I look at these fractals.
Sure.
And the worst part of the entire opening is at the end where there's a fractal of Nessa.
Yeah.
And it just looks way cheaper than the rest of the fractals because they had to force a girl into the fractals. You know what I mean? And it looks like a 90s OP for like a fucking Magical Girl anime or something.
She's got a bunch of little Nessas growing out of her like SpongeBob when he reproduces by budding.
But anyway, I think we're getting off topic.
Not really. I don't know. But we're introduced to this fractal system, which is supposedly some kind of utopia, no work land, except it's breaking down, except he doesn't seem to be working, but no one seems to really be working, but they kind of are, because they have, like, a market where they're selling stuff, but they're not, like, people aren't, like, aimless, workless zombies, but they're not, I don't know, and he's just, like, a strapping Ghibli lad, and I don't know what's going on.
Yes, Declan. Yes, you're very right. It's almost like this world isn't very well thought out or coherent.
It's a big old mishmash of a bunch of stuff.
Because he's walking around with a friend at the beginning or something at the fucking the market that they go to or
does
something.
Does he have someone,
like,
there?
A dude with him, and he's like his friend's like, I spent all of my ducats for this month, and he's like, oh, I can loan you some.
Oh,
ducats.
Yeah, they have Monet and Donay.
Yeah. wow.
I don't know what the difference is. I don't know if they go into that at all. It's like the video games. You got the two currencies.
Don't cops show up or something?
Yeah, they bust them for the data narcotics or something.
Oh my god. Oh my god.
But then he sees a girl. He sees a crazy girl on a girl on a crazy vehicle who's interrupting his boring simple life. This has never been done before.
This fucking straight out of Nausicaä ass, just straight rip.
Probably
of
it's like
Nausicaä
mixed with Fooly Cooly.
Yeah, and it also she gives him a look, and like when because they like make eye contact while she's escaping from these Team Rocket likes at the beginning, and the look that she gives him is so soulless and dead and off model. It's really really funny. It's
I might have taken a screenshot of that. Yeah, I don't know.
But yeah, and so they got these they're in pursuit of a mystery girl.
Yeah, she gets hurt. She falls. She jumps and looks like in the water, but then it turns out she just fell on a cliff. And her name's Fidune, they call her, but it's spelled like fern, like the almost like you'd pronounce it like a tree. And she's straying, and she's angry. She don't need no help. And then brings her to his house.
Don't get too attached to this version of this character, by the way. She becomes whatever the show needs her to be for effect.
Yeah,
she has
much.
No consistency. If she needs to be helpless, she will be helpless. This hard ass girl that they are not, you know, like tomboy that she's referred to at the beginning.
Right.
Is not what that character is by the end of the show.
Doesn't really come up a whole lot. And remember, don't appeal to those nasty otaku, but also she gets naked immediately.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, at first she's just a total weirdo, isn't she? I mean, she's saying all this stuff, and it doesn't help that Klain is obviously nothing. He's just a total wet noodle or soggy, whatever you call it. Soggy potato. And it would just... I just can't stop thinking about how much better this show and of course all anime would be if the protagonist was just like really cynically confused by all the main girl's weird hippie bullshit. Like if she were to just go, I can sense the effort put into every object, it's amazing, which is something she actually says. If he were to just stare at her and go, what, huh, it would just, that's all he has to do, but he doesn't.
Mm-hmm.
He just sits there.
She's
really bipolar at first. Going crazy.
I think Klain might be simple. I think he might be simple. I think he
might be a simpleton. Yeah, no.
I really don't think there's much higher thought going on inside of him.
It's a strong critique. He's never had a day of work in his life. He's got nothing going on upstairs.
Mm-hmm.
But the one scene I really did like in this first episode was the pursuants are revealed to be very incompetent, and they have a scene where they storm the house.
Yeah.
And it is very funny.
It's almost like those are the best characters in the show.
It's almost
like that duo of the duo and then Henry are like way more developed and interesting and like at least characters.
They're
rather
funny.
Than...
They are stolen straight from not Gatchaman, the fucking Yatterman. There, she's Dorombo, and they're the incompetent whatever their names are.
Hey, they provide much needed levity or anything of interest. And the jokes are good, and they land.
Those jokes are good. Yeah. Yeah. I don't remember what they were, but it's funny. And they are looking, but they're looking in the house for this girl, and Clayne literally has her dress, but then they're not there, and they just leave. Whatever. That's episode one. Episode two.
Also, the show still looks good at this point, or semi-good. The
show looks pretty good the entire time, actually.
Oh, I don't know. I thought that last episode looked like booty.
There are some shots in the last episode that are very funny. But I don't, the motion is very fluent throughout. I think it looks pretty nice. Even if the art design isn't really on top of things. But episode two, coming at you, still drunk. I made it all the way into two, and I'm still going for it. So there's another girl now. This one's a 21-year-old Kana Hanazawa, so she's better than the first one. But in the show, she's like 10, whatever. Her name's Nessa, and I like her better. This one's good. So,
I fucking knew you would. You're goddamn Mark. You're fucking... I knew it.
What?
She's nothing!
She's nice. She's got... Oh, my God. She's nice.
No.
God, I was... Oh, what's wrong with her?
What? She just doesn't... She has no real arc.
She loves love and she hates hate, man. You don't need to arc it for her from that. She's perfect. She's so cheerful. She likes to dance.
Yeah, she's obnoxious in this fucking show.
What is the matter with you?
Oh, my God.
All right. Well...
Clayne!
Everyone says everyone's name. It's an anime. You,
Clayne!
You drive me to drink. Hold on.
Not about Nessa in the show. I don't like her shtick. I don't like how... I mean, she's 10, and just, like, bubbly, and just a fucking total bubblehead.
I don't hear... Okay, you have to say something negative if you're going to convince me.
She just distracts from the overall narrative going on.
Again?
Like yeah, but, like... But I'm frustrated because I'm like, well, fucking get a move on, show. Like,
she's happy,
you know, like,
she's cute, she's got a pretty dress.
If the show has bad pacing, just interjecting with stuff that goes nowhere is not going to help that.
At one point, she says Zuto for like 10 or 12 seconds. Perfect.
Moving, let's continue. Agree or disagree.
All we need is one more girl and we have a harem, by the way. Don't let me down.
I thought Henry was close.
Not at this point, but yes, it's eventually we might be able to classify this as a harem. I don't know. We'll have to take it to the judges later. Also, tiny note: these disturbingly realistic dog barking noises. They got me again. They can put it in the back channel so well that I think it happens in real life. It's just every time. But. Which girl am I talking about that I say is a gremlin? I don't know. But
gotta be Henry.
Sure.
She's mischievous.
Is Nessa messing with electronics at this point? I don't know.
Oh, maybe
not. Did that happen? I don't know. But
No. Because is this when they're near that city and she's just causing shit to freak the fuck out?
Who knows? Whatever. But he just leaves her at a police station, which is stone cold. And his parent Doppels, are worried after like one day where something happens and they're just like, oh no, there's a girl here, are you okay?
Brought two home, brings home two girls in 2 days, baby.
Yeah, man. Just
playing.
Buy your son a cigar or something. I don't know what dads do. Uh-huh. And then Nessa sees a package and she grabs it and they get captured, but isn't that cute? I liked it, but then episode three, I wasn't drunk anymore.
Yes.
So.
The beer goggles came off.
This is where
the real show begins.
The vodka goggles are gone. Stronger than beer goggles, it turns out. But Clayne gets taken to a village with real physical objects, and he's very impressed by this, even though he lives in like a house. I don't know what's going on.
Well, it's because that's the only physical objects around him, probably, would be just the house, I guess.
They were at that marketplace, and they were stuck. I don't know.
No, the stuff disappeared. That was all fake.
Oh, sure.
It's all fakey fake. All right. Also, keep going. Never mind. I'll come to it at some point.
But yeah, the people trying to capture Nessa take them to this ultra trad village where they're all a bunch of like screaming Luddite straw men. But I don't know, it seems all right. I don't know, they just hang out there, and then Nessa starts bugging Enri. Enri is the feisty girl who's a tsundere, mm-hmm. by the way, and she's I don't know, she's got socks on, and Nessa follows her around and checks out her piss stats, and I paused on the screen and I made sure to note her piss stats. Okay,
give me the stats.
All right, first of all,
this is for our fantasy piss league.
Fantasy piss league, Enri. Okay, stats coming up. Very acidic. Okay.
Uh-oh.
Hadn't eaten that much today. It was like an apple and something else, and she burned she burned way more calories than she had eaten. So maybe trying to lose weight, not impossible to say.
Not that she needs it.
And I know she looks good. Uh-huh. But then on the screen it says she weighs 180. And I was like, "Whoa, what the hell?"
Okay, how does
what?
What about metric? How much is that in metric?
Well,
do we know?
The 180 must have been wrong because it said 42 kilograms, which is 92 Uh-oh. Pounds. So they must have doubled the weight for some reason. I don't know why.
Maybe that was before and after she peed. she really had to go.
She was half pee.
Yeah, it depends. Sometimes I feel like that, man, up to my eyes. You know what I'm saying? Like
every morning when I wake up. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Deflation porn.
Oh gosh.
I have a deflation fetish. These girls that start off big blobs and then they just let it.
deflation also, and also yellow golden shower fetish.
Just squat over a 10-gallon bucket and just fill that.
Gonna need more than 10-gallon, baby. I like my girls big.
I like my girls big, and then I like them to get real small. Oh man,
that's gross. God. That scene was okay, by the way.
Yeah, that's good. And then the next scene is good, where Klain tries out real soup. He loves it. And then Nessa, since she can't eat anything, asks him to dance the flavor. And he dances it, and it's very silly. And
yeah.
then the two silly villain, or you know, the two silly capturer guys watching their silhouettes, and it's like one of the guys adjusts his glasses and goes, "Whoa, he's good."
That's a good joke. Also, this is when the show is still about the characters instead of the concepts, and before it completely loses the plot. Because like they haven't introduced all of these. They've introduced a lot of the ideas, but they haven't cluttered the fuck out of it.
This is
yet.
When they only have like two or three things going on, and they can actually keep track of them.
Yeah, and then you get simple character moments like that that are just completely gone by the end of the show.
This entire village is obsessed with this dude fucking this like 12-year-old boy. Just everyone can't stop.
Yeah,
because
the big ladies are interested in it.
He's a pervert.
We'll talk about later.
He's pervert. He can't stop. Yeah. He's doing lewd things with the girls constantly. They can't stop talking about it.
That'd really affect your sexuality if you're that age. You'd be pretty fucked up.
You'd be pretty psyched. But
yo,
all right, sleep. Yeah, I'm getting it. Hold on. My cat is. Turn towards me. Hey. Oh, she's got a big red thing on her nose. What is that? Oh, God.
Uh-oh.
It's so bright. What is... Is that a tick? Wait, come here. Hold
uh-oh,
on.
It's tick season, baby. You gotta watch out.
Right, come here. What is that? It's so huge. Come over here.
Is it a tick?
I don't know. I can't see. She's too far away. Hey, come here. Come on.
Ooh.
The one time she doesn't want to come
here. I hope it's not a tick.
I've pulled ticks off cat noses before. Hey, come on.
Oh, ticks are like the worst shit ever.
Oh, fuzzy. Oh, it just fell off. She's good. Oh, it just went in her mouth.
Some bullshit.
It's probably some insulation. She likes to climb in the ceiling.
Yeah. We've got rodents that like to climb in our ceiling here.
Oh, I hear them at night. Oh, I hear them climbing, crawling through the...
Little rodent buddies. They're watching out for us.
Did you go... I have to look at apartments. And I took one shot of vodka. I'm already going off topic.
Yeah.
But...
Uh-huh.
I don't want to do it because how did you did you do the thing where the person selling you the place was showing you around and you have to like obsessively look behind the fridge and look in the cabinets for mouse droppings and look in the cupboards for roach poison and check the corners for bed bug marks and all that
stuff?
You
see, it was really easy when we were looking for places, the place that we're at now, because there were just giant rat traps outside of all of the possible entrances of the place, so we just knew we were getting into.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
Honesty.
Just bring your mom with you.
That's what I was gonna do, I don't know how that's gonna help.
Well, because she's looked for places before, and then you get another set of eyes. She has another set of eyes then, or you know.
I'm just saying, I'm afraid of the literal awkward situation of the person showing me this place and just staring at me as I like get on my knees and like check in the cupboards and check the water pressure, check the sinks. I just don't want someone looking at me while I do.
So what's going to happen is they're going to walk you around the place.
Yeah.
And then they're going to be like, okay, and you can just go ahead and look through wherever. And they're going to go on their phone, and then you have the house to yourself basically to walk through.
That's what I was hoping for. Do they do that?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that's great.
All of my experiences were like that.
Oh, fantastic.
And they'll be like, yeah, and if you want to just check the place out, I'll be back in a moment. You know what I mean? But that's my experience. You might encounter somebody who's like, what you looking at? Oh, no, there's nothing down there. Don't worry about it. Oh, no, there's no bed bugs here.
My nightmare.
No bed bugs, big boy. No. Oh, don't look down there.
You're very insistent about this. You're being very
I'm looking out for you.
Defensive.
I'm your friend. Declan, you should fucking sign the lease, you fuck.
Oh.
Why don't you sign a lease right now? You got a little dick? You got a little dick, little dick boy?
I think I should maybe think about it a little.
No. What are you thinking about? You're home, think about it with your fucking small dick?
I'm just
small
not,
dick guy?
Oh.
Show me it. Pull out and show me it.
I don't really want to.
Get your dick out. Show me how fucking small it is, you small dick boy.
This is a vile. This is
what are you afraid of? You afraid of fucking bugs? You afraid of bug
kind of
pussy?
Rule. I mean, kind of. They're not. I don't really want to live in a place with that kind of.
You afraid the bugs are gonna be bigger than your little dick? I don't think it's gonna be like that. I think it's probably gonna be more like, and just go ahead and take a look at the place. You know, feel out the space, and then they like text their fucking boyfriend or something.
Nice.
Yeah. That answers your question.
Thank you.
Yeah, got you.
What's going on in Fractale? So it's. So when they're dancing and it's some kind of, and they're joking about them fucking, it is at this point where I pause the show, minimize it, and desperately search for Fractale Dojins.
Oh, yeah.
Only to find that, and this never happens, there are literally zero, not even, usually there's like some kind of weird, you know, image collection or...
Yeah, or like fan art that's
or just
got like,
bad,
they got
like
big old girl
bad,
dicks.
Like fake CG or yeah, just like something terrible. There's like one, and it's obviously like awful. There's like nothing. I uh-huh. knew this show wasn't popular, but man, like zero lewd stuff's very strange.
I think it's because everybody was so turned off by this show based on all the weird sex stuff going on, like towards the second half, where everybody who was going to draw porn for this then was like, this is just gross even for me, and then didn't
me
do
in
it.
This man, I don't want to be involved.
Yeah. I'm not going to taint my reputation. Goes back to drawing furry, gyro,
no.
Deflation porn.
So, oh, by the way, I just saw that Connor is now playing Rocksmith, so have fun with that in the other room.
He plays it with headphones on. He good.
But he's playing a real guitar, isn't he?
What? I can't know. There's no way I'm going to hear him from my part of the room.
Oh, all right.
No, it plugs it into your computer, man. It's the jack, like the quarter inch jack that goes into the guitar is a USB. It goes in the computer.
I guess he is across the house. I'm just saying that guitar is making real noise.
Oh yeah,
a little bit, anyways. But
he's got carpet. He's good.
But okay, so I should note this show is basically totally G rated until this point. Well, okay, PG rated until this point, right?
Mm-hmm.
About.
Yeah, the girl's a little bit naked in the first episode or whatever.
A little bit.
But nothing too...
Yeah,
too,
I think if this were a Disney movie, PG, so far.
Uh-huh.
And then they're... So this village is actually one of the bases for a group called Lost Millennium, which is trying to get rid of Fractale because they want to live like the olden days, like the old regime. And so at the end of this episode, it's haha, time for war, buddy. And they go to this fractal ceremony where they're doing something, upgrading the nanobots or something. And they put on some They Live glasses, and everyone's freaking out. So, and then people just start getting fucking stone cold murdered.
This is and it's really out of place and inappropriate in the show.
So totally, completely tone deaf. Like, there's no tone to this. It's like the music isn't even that heavy. They just start mowing down these nuns.
Yep. This is
nothing.
This is so much like that type of person who's like, I'm gonna fucking like animated days bullshit. I'm gonna make something real, you know, like fucking like this is real, man. War, like just it, like, trying to traumatize children because they think that's good art. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like, dude, all the shit I watched when I was growing up was fucked up. I'm gonna throw brutal murder in. It's brutal civilian murder. We're gonna follow it. Like our heroes are terrorists. You know what I mean? Like just committing atrocities against civilians, just totally innocent people who are caught up in brainwashed. I mean, they are aware that they're brainwashed, and just eradicate them.
Yeah, and
really fucked up.
But just like a really like not. It's just given no weight whatsoever. It's very strange. And at first it's like, okay, this show is basically like a big old fight between a bunch of primitivists and a bunch of transhumanists. Tale as old as time, of course. But
yeah,
it's, you know, at first it's like, okay, these guys, they're like watching this ceremony and everyone's kind of freaking out, but maybe that's just an unfortunate side effect of their nanomachines getting upgraded because they all look like their eyes are dead and they're shaking and whatever. But, you know, you can kind of see, like, maybe, you know, I don't know. No, this, you can kind of see what's going on. Maybe they're not totally black and white. But then later, the villain just gets so ridiculous, which we'll get into.
Yep.
It gets like, so like off
just
the rails.
Making him as unrelatable and just unambiguously horrible as possible. like every conceivable thing that you could think of to make somebody a bad person, they went for.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And even beyond, like, again, we'll get to it. But yeah, that scene's really out of place and terrible.
The whole rest of the show was almost out of place. Like, this was basically a comedy adventure.
Until
people started getting blown the fuck apart.
Well, then it's war. Then it's fucking war for the rest of the show.
A named character, one of the funny dudes, Butcher, they called him, right? Yeah. He just gets fucking just blown through the chest.
I think the last scene that I like in this show happens in either this or the next episode when they decide to go take down the mothership. You know what I mean?
Yeah, like episode four is basically or no, it's not that one. I don't know. But I don't know. Something. There's one episode that's basically just comedic relief later. But yeah, this scene doesn't work where they're murdering all the civilians and nuns. It's just really weird. And there's like
clean doesn't stand for anything.
Oh no.
What the fuck? Like, are they still captives at this point? I don't know.
I don't know. But and then he sees and there's like another Nessa and another friend or whatever. But episode four comes around. There's just been a mass civilian casualty incident. What do you do? How about some etchy jokes? This guy is a pervert. Pervert. Etchy.
Our friend just died.
Morning. Okay, etchy joke. Lost Millennium is in trouble now because they just murdered a bunch of nuns. And that's basically it. That's the whole episode. I don't think anything happens in episode four. You got anything?
Is that the... Does he have the camera in that episode? Or is that a later episode? When does he get the camera?
Is that this one? No, that's episode so. 6. No, he gets later. The camera at 6.
Okay. Holy shit.
Yeah, I don't know what happens in episode 4. Episode 5, they're on the airship, and there's a bunch of huge Germanic women taking my boy's pants off.
Yeah!
Great.
Did you see my tweet?
What's that?
You see my tweet?
Oh, no.
Oh, I made a tweet about Fractal.
Oh.
Fractal. In regards to that.
Wait, hold on. Oh, you've been doing the tweeting.
Oh, yeah.
Fractale. Big, big ladies.
There's big ladies in this show, and they grope all over my boy. Like they're like, God. So yeah, they kind of have like there's like an episode that's basically. Clayne getting adjusted to life on this ship, pictures on their pirate ship.
Pictures of English. Oh, it's all... Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Googled pictures of... What the fuck? I didn't even notice. Whole Journal of the Statistician Society.
Yeah. Wow. Well, it's just... every book says pictures of English or that on it.
Pictures of
English. I think I couldn't let that go. I needed that to be recognized.
Pictures of you. Pictures of English.
But yeah, just slice of life on the ship. This is the one where Nessa goes into the system and
she plays hide and seek. I think I'm drunk again for this one, by the way. I don't know. He's thinking about Nessa for some reason. This is the one where everyone's really super obsessed with Clayne fucking. And then he hacks the airship with his iPod to find Nessa. Nessa starts to, like, malfunction. The ship's, like, air conditioning or something, so everyone gets really hot. Even though they're, like, moving through the air and there's windows. I don't know how that works. But then they decide that in order to bring her back and make her not mad anymore, they have a dance party. That episode's really dumb.
Yep.
Episode 6. My only notes for this episode are full on ass. Because there's a butt.
Oh, she jumps in the water with
the butt. She jumps in the water. She got a butt on the screen.
So, homie, there's a dude who's like, they stop to go swimming or something, or like they just stop to camp out on land for a bit. And Nessa and Henry and fucking Frine. Furine they all go swimming, and then they see a creepy voyeur taking photos of them from a distance. He's like, "Hey, get back here, you creepy voyeur!" And then Clayne goes and meets up with the guy later because he's like, "Oh my god, that guy's a camera. That's fascinating to me." So he goes to the dude's house later that night. He abandons his post, and also nothing comes of him abandoning his post. They make a big deal about how like, "Hey, Clayne, you're on watch tonight." And then I thought it was going to be like he had to make a choice between going to see this old man with a camera or staying watch or, you know, keeping watch. But nothing ends up coming of that at all.
Yeah.
So he goes and sees the old man, and the old man tells him about technology or something. And he shows him what his goal is. The old guy's a goal. He wants to bring the system or the fractal system back to this town or whatever, because it was like a really beautiful society or civilization.
Yeah,
it's a nice Irish town.
Because I guess Fractal's not working there for some reason, even though it looks kind of the same as his house where Fractal kind of was working. But they see some settlers moving, and they're moving to a different place because there's no more Fractal. So I guess I don't know.
What the fuck is even going on with this system in this world? Is this why they have to reboot it? Because it's like becoming consolidated in one city and then there's haves and have-nots? Yeah, I don't know.
It's breaking down because there's no key, I guess.
Fucking whatever. But so they go and check out the town, and then Buddy gives him, the old man gives him a camera, and then like Ferdinand like fucking steals some photos, and Nessa's like, "Oh, look at these photos." And then in the photo, it shows a photo from earlier in the show that's of Clayne's family, and it's kind of revealed that this old man was Clayne's dad for no reason.
Yeah.
And nothing comes of that. And now Clayne has a camera that he uses twice.
Yeah. Yeah, so sweaty camera dad. Sweaty camera perv dad. He, like, shows him a bunch of holograms. It's like, this is what it's going to be like when I get the fractal booting up over here or something.
Yep.
That's it.
Because he's got this giant antenna in his house. That never result. We never see him again. The camera is only seen, like, once more than, like, the next episode. There's a lot of setups that have no payoff in this fucking show, man.
But in episode 7, they're back on that airship. Mm-hmm. And my boy is nude, and he's waking up next to some sweet jigglies because he's not in the airship anymore. They crashed because Nessa was disappearing, and she broke their little dinghy or something. And this one he spends in the city of Xanadu, And isn't that a Pokemon?
Subtle.
What's this? I don't get it. What is
Well, Xanadu is you know, kind of used as like a perfect world, or you know what I mean? Like, yeah. Xanadu is the name of
the 1980 movie starring Olivia Newton-John.
Yeah, of course.
Oh.
Or like
and Gene Kelly and Michael Beck.
Citizen Kane's or you know, Charles Foster Kane's estate in Citizen Kane is called Xanadu, and it's like this supposed to be his perfect like estate that he built with all of his power, and ends up being just kind of hollow and meaningless because all of this is for nothing.
There's a lot of Xanadus on Wikipedia. There's Xanadu, an enigmatic bright feature on the surface of Saturn's moon Titan, and there's also Xanadu 2.0, the nickname of Bill Gates' futuristic private estate. And there's a Xanadu house, the series of experimental homes built to showcase computers and automation in the home. And there's Madrid Xanadu, a large shopping mall and entertainment center in Spain.
Xanadu, I think, has a negative connotation. I don't know why you would use it to describe something you're trying to show off technology with. That seems stupid.
Does it have a negative connotation because you think of it as having some kind of dark underbelly?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's why he did it then.
Well, because he wants to show off. No. Not in the show. I'm saying in like.
Oh, like for Bill Gates.
If you're, yeah, or Bill Gates. Or Xanadu 2.0 is like, well, your empire, it brings you no fulfillment, Mr. Gates. Or like, if you're using it to show off smart home stuff, you know what I mean? Like, it's not.
Bill Gates' estate is a cry for help.
Yeah. Oh, no. He's so alone. Oh, he's got a homegirl. Bill. What's her name?
Melinda Gates.
Melinda.
Yes.
Bolinda. I don't know.
Ebola Gates.
Oh, no. That's hot takes. Wait, no. Aren't they trying to stop Ebola?
I don't know. Isn't what the fuck. I don't think they have anything to do with Ebola. I just said that. I don't know, because it sounds like Melinda.
I know, but I'm just saying. They're trying to stop viruses and shit.
All right.
Malaria. They're after malaria.
Malaria Gates. Change your name. Bring awareness. So, he's got this Doppel lady in Xanadu, and he's cross-dressing for some reason, and... Nessa's got a virus, and nothing really ever comes of that. She kind of gets over it. And there's an angry statue man. Nessa, and then they're gonna get captured. The guy's betraying them, so Nessa goes berserk and destroys the whole city.
And you get your first hint of actual fractals in the show.
A little bit, and then Clayne is fucking dead, gone, shot with a gun, and you're to blame.
Oh wow, this is this is like what you would imagine a city where everybody has like a virtual reality world or like augmented reality world would look like. Because it's just a bunch of like pillars that augmented reality is then displayed upon. So like they could walk around these buildings or whatever. Why is it like this here and not in the other places that have the Fractale system? How come all the other places had like
not working as well there?
Even the places where when you could see what it did work when it was working, what it looked like were just quaint Irish towns.
It was only working a little bit though.
Okay, I guess fucking. This is the place where the Fractale system works perfectly or some bullshit.
It's the best. Yeah, it's working the best there. That's why this whore offers to. At one point, she just says like, "Hey, want to go back to the hotel room and bang and do cyber drugs all day?" And I was like, "Man." Ooh.
Her hangers, man. She's got hangers.
It's not a very protagonist thing to do, but man, that sounds kind of great.
Clayne is a sexless baby man. Baby boy.
Baby boy. Yeah, kind of.
He's not even a golden retriever. He's not even like a dog. He's just kind of like off-white paint for your wall. Just like enough character without being, but it might as well not exist.
Yeah,
I don't know if I'm getting my point across.
I don't know, but
fucking whatever forced metaphor.
So episode 8. This episode's only 11 episodes, by the way. If it feels like we're like a third of the way through the story, no, like we're almost wrapping up.
Mercifully,
we got some good, healthy father daughter tummy. What is this adjective I typed down? Snigging? What is snigging? Did I mean snuggling? Or
Snugging? Maybe you were
snugging?
Going for...
I don't know what snugging means, but something.
Snuggling? I don't know.
He's touching her belly a lot is what I'm trying to say.
Not appropriate behavior for a father.
I mean, I don't know. You know, dads give you raspberries, you know?
Not when you're a full-blossomed woman. Not when you're in the peak of your womanhood.
Hey, he doesn't think of her like that. She's the same little girl he's always known and loved.
Yeah, you know what? Maybe I'm looking at this the wrong way.
Yeah,
maybe
you're
he's
really projecting, you weirdo. You sick fucking creep.
You're right. It's totally normal to grope your 18-year-old daughter.
You don't understand the bond.
How are we so judgmental, huh?
Yeah. You don't know what they've been... You don't know their relationship, mm-hmm. but... Mm-hmm. But yeah, this is when... the bad guy, the leader of the pro Fractale gang, he goes from unmemorable to being just ridiculous.
He was largely ineffectual towards the beginning of the show and not at all intimidating.
Yeah, then
we were able to escape from him.
He starts feeling on that belly, and he's the bad guy in a Yamakan show, so of course he's a purity fag, where he's going on about how pure she is. Actually, Mari Okada wrote this show, so that also makes sense. But then, she's showing Clayne around, and there's clone Nesses. It's been 20 years, and we still haven't been able to get through one show that doesn't rip off Evangelion.
Yep.
So,
I saw this more as a ripoff of, Pokemon, the first movie. You know when they, you know the sequence where they got all the clone Pokemon to fight each other?
The part of your brain that draws comparisons is fundamentally broken.
No. It's exactly like Pokemon the first movie, because they clone all the Pokemon, and then the two clone Pikachus fight each other. I was intentionally
just go to Evangelion. That's
because I was intentionally drawing a poor comparison because you would hit the one that made the most sense. So I'm like, I'm going to derail this. I'm going to distract from the fact that you found the right one by going for something intentionally horrible.
Okay, sure.
Because I just wanted something with a clone in it and tubes, and because I'm like, well, Declan already found the one, so I could fuck this up a little bit.
That's a good call. So
just spicing it.
Yeah. And now Furune has to get a hymen exam in this show that again was originally
bad and wrong.
What is
just
the,
bad?
What is the tone of this show? What is it? And then they even destroy the clones, like Evangelion.
Oh my god.
And then,
they can't do this.
And then the base blows up, self-destructs. And the other Nessa clone that helps him out gets exploded, too. She stands in the fire.
Oh my god.
It's very sad. She's the special one. It's just like in Railgun, when they have the one special clone who has the one distinguishing feature, and she's like that in the show that came after that show.
Wow. It's a good thing that this came around and saved anime, because like, I was really, really worried that it was going to be mostly derivative garbage.
I did try to find out if he ever... I couldn't find the source of him saying he was going to save anime. So I don't... That might be... It might be
fan talk that got taken as gospel.
That might be a bit of an exaggeration of Yamakan, but this certainly did not save anything. But yeah, episode 9 now. It's time for a showdown. They're gonna go to the temple itself, bring things to them, and they take a family photo of a lost millennium to remember everyone. And Enri gets very close to a confession, so close to that harem end. And then Nessa says Zuto for a very, very long time. And then Furune decides to run away, and she gives him a sleepy kissu. And then this is the part where him and Nessa could have just banged forever and birthed like a whole village on their own, but she convinces him to chase after Furune instead, and that's why the rest of the show happens when it didn't happen.
Well, she's a doppel, kind of, maybe, though.
But she can do the touch, she's just a perch.
Now I understand.
No, you didn't understand.
Thank you for clarifying that for me. I'm aroused.
I don't know what...
She can do the touch.
She can. I'm not just saying it. They bring it up.
Wow, that's crazy. That's fucking crazy. The implications. I don't.
What are you doing?
This show. I'm kind of sick right now. So I'm in a really hot room.
Yeah, dude. So
I'm kind of fading into the distance.
Why do rooms get so hot when you do podcasts? I was freezing right before we started this. Is it just the act of talking that makes you hot?
Yeah. You do a lot of thinking. You know, you burn a lot of calories with the brain muscles.
Noggin's jogging.
Yeah. You got to keep yapping for a whole hour, you know?
Yeah.
We're
exactly an hour.
Anyways, we're approaching the finale, the stunning climax to Fractale.
Episode 10. I've never played a Final Fantasy game, but I feel like this is Final Fantasy. It's like an assault with a bunch of steampunk airships on a temple. I don't know.
Not too far off.
And Clayne gets punched. That's fun. That should happen more. The show would be better. And then they're flying into this temple. The best shot of the show, which I posted some screenshots to you just before we started. It's all these nuns and like mages, like pointing forward, like they're charging, like go get them. And we haven't even mentioned the character, the leader of Lost Millennium, because I don't even know what his name is, but he's a spunky dude. And he throws a grenade at them, and they don't move at all. They don't animate, but they just explode.
That was hilarious.
They're drawn very, very simply. Like
this is
like
where the direction starts to get really, really poor. Like this is when it really, like just on a technical level, starts to break down for me. Where there's just edits that are really inappropriate, and like exciting music will be going, and there's no fade or anything. We'll just cut to the next scene, and the music just stops. You know what I mean? And stuff like that. It's just fucking so. Just filmmaking 101 is being thrown out the window, we're just jumping around to all these different, you know, things going on and not in a way that works at all. It's just really jarring and horrible.
Would you say that it's dense?
It's so dense. You can't. The thing is, you can't pull anything out of it because it's all
Rick
essential plot.
Berman.
There's so much going on in every frame.
There's a lot going on.
There's so many yelling nuns in every frame.
But it's a lot.
Can I mention something?
Yeah.
The security guards don't animate when they fire their lasers out of their stupid rods. Oh God. That's the worst. I don't know how that design or like that idea made it to the screen of like firing lasers from their staffs. And also what's going on? Why is this a cult? Why do they need all these cult folks?
Because he has to make it evil somehow.
But like what? Why can't they just be brainwashed like the rest of the people using Fractale? How come they have to be like
the ones
like Steve O'Keefe
controlling the process?
Why can't it just be like one person? Why can't it be like Oz? You know what I mean?
We need a bunch of people to pray to whatever.
Oh my God! No subtlety, like, not good.
They're just sort of. He tries to make them off-putting by making them really religious, I guess. I don't know.
They're fanatics. You know what I mean? Like they're not.
But they're also just kind of right because they do have to do the stuff that they do. It looks like. I don't know.
Why are the soldiers fucking? I don't know.
Fun tidbit. Did you notice that Clayne's last name is my name?
Oh boy, did I! I'm like, it's Declan's name, and then I paused it and went to the bathroom.
You paused it in what? I didn't hear that.
I went to the bathroom. I was like, huh?
I can't handle this.
I had to go gather myself.
I looked it up.
What does it mean?
Except then I looked it up, and his name isn't. It's not actually his name. His name is Necron, and the sub.
Oh, they just fucked it up.
I heard it. I mean, it does sound like, you know, they don't. It's coming through a radio. It's hard to hear, but yeah, that's not correct. But
Crane Necron.
Clayne Necron, great name.
Necron's a bad. They're bad names in this Necron thing, man.
Yeah, there's not a again, not much of a strong vibe coming off these.
We managed to get all the way here without mentioning Diaz, because that guy is totally non-essential.
Diaz? And which one's he?
He's the other rebel leader guy, the sexy one. Yeah, yeah.
He's the more cutthroat guy, more Machiavellian.
He's more confident. He just doesn't strike me as evil. He's just like he knows what needs to be done.
Yeah.
And he's suave and sexy. And but like he just sacrifices himself in that. And it's almost like they're set up like our main rebellion dude was gonna go after Alabaster, or like they were gonna have like a disagreement of some kind. Because they greet each other, and Alabaster's like, oh, hello, our guy. And our dude's like, Diaz. And that never mounts to anything.
Well, they do get mad at each other at one point. Or he gets mad at Albatross at one point and punches him. Alabaster.
Yeah, like briefly.
But
I don't know.
But yeah, they set this character up. In this show that's 11 episodes, they set him up for like 5 minutes. Yeah. Previously, and then he dies unceremoniously in 5 seconds.
He does blow himself up.
Yes.
Which is kind of neat, I guess. Self-sacrifice.
There's also like a princess lady, and I don't know what her job is. But at this Frin are having a meeting, and Frin's like, you need me as the key to save Fractale? Well, I'm going to stab myself in the neck. I swear I'm going to do it. And then the princess is like, all right, I'm just going to choke you to death yet. Then. Women are retarded.
She didn't do it. She got like most of the way and then was able to bring herself out of it because she knew what she needed her. It's to make her suffer a little bit. That's all.
Then Nessa's got a crazy magic circle. And then the bad guy gets even more bad. He just starts going so off the rails. It's like a joke. Like he's like, it's like even more than the bad guy from the second season of Sword Art Online. Or no, the second half of the first season of Sword Art Online, I think. Where he's just licking girls and holding wombs and just like mocking, just going, oh, you're gonna cry? You're gonna cry, you baby?
I'm so evil.
Insulting.
Yu-Gi-Oh villain, but with a weird sex fetish.
As a viewer, it's just so insulting. It's just so condescending. I hate it.
It's not condescending. It's lazy. It's just lazy,
Episode
man. Episode
10 ends with no music on shots of Klain and Nessa's faces as they react as Frin's dad is licking and like molesting her in front of them. This show's hilarious.
The last episode picks up from there, but without the molestation part.
Yeah.
Where I'm like, where is this gonna go? Like, how far is this show gonna go? And then it stops.
It doesn't. Yeah. They.
It stops.
The episode 11 opens up. It's like, okay, never mind. He's just standing next to her.
It's.
He's not doing any more like.
Fractale is the show that goes nowhere. They want you to believe that it's going so many different places. Like it's supposed to be this grand journey, and like wow, they're sky pirates, and they're taking down the system. But in the end, it feels like we've fucking barely gone anywhere.
Yeah, it's
like
they're just going to a boring space garden.
Yep.
For
30 seconds, and there's no spectacle. There's no spectacle at all.
But you know what's great? In episode 11, we finally learn the truth. The villain tells us, it's time for you to finally learn the truth about this world. And then
oh, thank God.
And then it's nothing. It's nothing. There's nothing really interesting.
How are they the key? Is, like, the code... Is, like, the code for Fractale is stored inside this girl?
The god
like
is...
In her DNA?
God's personality is in Nessa, but his body is Frin, so they have to combine
something bad, not good.
Really, really not good.
Oh God! Like,
he
and
explains
they
it for like the first 5 minutes of this episode, and it's just like, dude, I don't. This is so uninteresting.
Well, it doesn't even make sense. Like, I can't even like. It doesn't. I don't feel like I'm anything's being revealed to me because it's not anything that I could have come to on my own. You know what I mean? Like, they're the key, and like the. But it's never really explained like what they do other than, I guess, like just refresh the operating system of Fractale, I guess.
Yeah.
In like the fact that they were once the same girl carries no sort of like real weight, and just horrible anticlimax. Just like the one of the worst I've ever seen of like completely blowing 10 episodes of lead up. Not that the lead up had, you know, like built stakes or anything, but like you would think they would try to resolve it in a grand, meaningful way, and they just don't at all. It's so stupid. They just watch a TV. They literally watch a TV screen of a fucking like a fucking bubbly teenage girl. Yeah.
That seemed like it was supposed to be like emotional, like the Cowboy Bebop episode they ripped off. Remember mm-hmm. that one?
Yeah.
And but this teenage girl that's supposed to be like the girl that Frin is like reincarnated from or whatever, she just comes off as being crazy because she's like. First of all, she's supposed to be like 16. She's like, she sets up a camera. She's like, I'm going to go to work. I'm going to go to my first job. My dad's not going to get mad at me. I love my little bunny friend. Hippity hoppity hip. And it's like, whoa, this girl is out of her mind.
Well, because you would hope that it would be like, this is the girl that developed the program or something. But she's not less significant than that. She's meaningless. She has no significance. Like... She's it totally inconsequential to everything that's led up to this. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Oh, and by the way, in Bad Boy's opening, in the monologue he does in this episode, we do get implied rape, because Yamakan has to take it to those haters.
Cleans thousand yard stare for like 30 seconds.
And he's like and this evil man's like, ha, I've taken this girl, she's impure, but our good protagonist, he shows him, man, he's like, ha, I'm gonna take those used goods, ha, I showed you buddy, I really gotcha.
Is this the episode that has the really inappropriate title card like drop,
that otaku probably, or the I don't know,
really bad OP drop.
I didn't know.
Where, like, oh, where right, it's like yeah. the end of like a villain monologue and then the opening starts rather than starting on
it's like
the opening.
In the middle of the villain
yeah,
monologue.
Yeah.
She erased her memories after a traumatic incident.
Yeah. This is just an extension of the poor direction that's going on at this point. Really just completely off the fucking rails.
Yeah, but Frin stabs her dad.
Oh, that's hilarious too.
Yeah, really
that's fucking the best.
She like she goes 1 inch into his like side.
Yeah,
and he's collapsing. He's like, oh, it hurts. After he's like just mocking everyone and just like screaming and laughing in their faces and drooling all and licking all over the place.
It's not scary. Like you could like, how about he like freaks the fuck out and he's like, you fucking bitch. You know what I mean? Or like, you know, chases her down or anything. Like,
why would you do this? Oh.
Yeah, really pathetic. Really just. Like, not pathetic as in like the characters being pathetic. Pathetic that this is how they wrote it. Right. You know what I mean? Yeah. Or equally pathetic, I guess. Oh my god.
But then he just takes Nessa and Frin up to Fractale, which is just like a big flower garden on a space elevator, and they stand on the thing and they sing the song.
Where's their garden?
Because it's supposed to be nature here, whatever.
But like, it's not mystical. It's all science. It's all steeped
it's magic
in science
or something. I don't know.
Boo.
But then they sing the song that was foreshadowed as being important, and then they...
God, the fucking song. Every time I wanted to die. I wished for death every time that song, like, they started singing it. I hate singing, like, just a cappella singing from a character. It's like, this is significant, or like, this is emotional.
Right,
and
yeah.
I that's like one of my least favorite tropes ever, and this show does it time and time and time again, and then they do it in the last scene, and I'm like, fucking, no, you can't get me. I don't think that's no goosebumps, zero emotional response to this at all.
Yeah, it doesn't do much for me either. But they reboot it. They reboot that Fractale. Then everyone's farmers then. Even though Fractales... It's supposed to be some kind of compromise, even though they just straight up reboot Fractale. I don't see why Lost Millennium gets anything out of this.
The compromise is that this is the last time Fractale can be rebooted, so eventually it will be gone. Like, okay. So the people have time to adapt
to like
a new world.
Everyone's living in Xanadu now. It's just like it looks like they're living in Tradville, but it's apparently Fractale's back. I don't know how it's back. They're just farming.
Well, I think these people are choosing to live outside of Fractale's influence, and then more like as it, you know, fades, they'll be able to have a society built for them to live in.
But it was like a thousand years. I don't know. Whatever.
I might be reading really like way too far.
I don't know why
they
didn't just do that before, or even though they kind of
explain that better.
Yeah, just
or just explain what's going on better
a little bit. But yeah, it's almost like a Code Geass because they're riding around on the farm things. And Klain's still in his house, and he's got a sleepy girl that's like a combination of Frin and Nessa. She's like Frin with like Nessa's personality or something.
Worst of both worlds.
But with Frin's, I was thinking about like, dude, like how about the exact opposite? Everything is wrong with Yamakan.
She's got dead eyes too, like just completely soulless. Also, everybody starts to look pretty soulless by the end of this. Klain looks soulless in the, like an off model in the final scene. No, not good. And then the bird flies into the sun.
Meaningful
the
seagull
end.
Shot. I don't know. Yeah, she's just like she wakes up after a year, and he's like not surprised. And then she's like, by the way, I love you too. And then he freaks out. I don't... Whatever, man.
Ugh.
But, this show kind of blows.
Real fucking disaster.
I was like halfway through. I was like, yeah, this is like okay. But boy, that really, really screws the pooch.
The last three episodes are very trying. they're really...
Yeah, I was ready.
Take a lot out of you.
Done by the end.
Yeah.
But yeah, this show has been mocked endlessly, and I had to see it because, you know, it was very hyped by its creators, supposedly, and it was trying to be a whole lot, and it not only was it not good, it sold, like, I think 773 copies, which has become a unit of measurement. One Fractale, one FRT.
It's got
shows are measured in now.
I hope all of those are in a museum somewhere. So we can just remember.
They're out there somewhere, man. I remember the show got made fun of a lot, and then it got brought over here, and I think it was Funimation. God bless them. They made a trailer for this show that makes it look awesome.
Really?
the trailer for the English dub of Fractale is like absolutely 100% epic. Made me. I was like watching. I was like, "This show's supposed to suck." Whoa, this looks great. Adventure.
Nothing. It's they must have taken the 5 minutes of adventure and crammed it into that trailer.
That trailer's well put together. I encourage.
They've cut together way worse shows at this point.
I encourage watching that trailer instead of this program.
I don't want to give it as much as saying there's interesting concepts in this, but like. Rebelling against a horrible techno dictatorship or like fucking everybody's addicted to technology and you're trying to like shake that. Like I like that idea. Not when it's done like this at all. I like techno rebellion is always cool, but Matrix already did that. So fucking, you know, what is left to be told in that? You know what I mean? Because that's what this isn't the show basically just probably about, like, addiction to the internet at its core.
There's only one person that can do this, and you know Ted Kaczynski has an anime written. You know he has a 36-episode anti-technology epic he's been working on in his cell since the 90s.
Yeah, dude, it's going to be the bomb. I didn't like this show very much at all. The first episode showed a level of promise, maybe because I was drunk, but I really do think there's stuff in like the first two episodes
absolutely.
Is like
no,
like this like
episodes.
This works. Like the you know, the team Henry and Co being like a Team Rocket, those jokes landed pretty well. There was a hint. There was some inklings early on that this was going to be really bad though. Where like Henry's riding around on a motorcycle, like escaping from the techno rape man, and there's just like six motorcycles just randomly in this location that she's in, and she jumps on one.
Frin is on the motorcycle.
I'm sorry, Frin, my bad. Yeah. But like that scene is very, very silly, and like that whole escape is silly. She jumps into the sky, like out into the horizon. in like, and there's like a freeze frame of that, and it's supposed to be epic, but it's really, really just hilarious and not well done at all.
And so, weird thing. What is Yamakan? I think Yamakan's got a thing. He's working on something. What are you doing, my man?
Oh, what a mess. What a mess. Xanadu looks like fucking garbage, and there's just so many different clashing styles going on there, and I think the largest flaw in this is a total lack of world building or coherent world building, and I never once feel like I have an idea of where I am in the world or like what are we even fighting for.
What are we fighting for?
Exactly.
Oh, we need to talk about that. Okay, two things. First of all, Yamakan's got a movie coming out in 2018.
Sign me up.
Called Twilight.
Oh my god, yes!
I have a feeling if I Google Twilight anime, I'm not going to get what I want. Oh no.
I would definitely watch a Yamakan-directed Twilight anime.
Oh, it's crowdfunded. Wow.
Ooh.
It just looks like it's just a girl with a violin case on her.
How far are the mighty have fallen?
15 million yen, apparently.
So, $150,000?
Yamamoto was planning the anime as the last of his described Tohoku trilogy, set in Japan's Tohoku region. What?
That's a stretch. Like, if you're late...
Like, wake up, girls. Far too unreasonable circumstances piling up. Are you there?
I'm here.
Oh, okay.
I was listening intently.
Oh, yeah. He's taken indefinite leave, or he was last May. I don't know. Whatever. But also, we got to talk about that Battle Angel Alita trailer, my man.
I didn't see it yet. Should I watch it now?
Live watch. Go right now.
Okay. I've heard something about eyes. That was shot in my town, man.
We're both. Oh yeah. Shot. Yeah, that's all CG.
It was on a soundstage and
all right, ooh. Sure. Well, we gotta watch it at the same time.
Have you seen it?
Well, yeah, but.
I just want to see where I'm at.
Yeah.
Ready? Three. I'm up. Should I click in and then? Okay, I'm on zero. Ready?
Yes.
3, 2, 1. Click.
Okay.
Oh, those are big eyes. Wow.
They're big.
Oh.
You hate acapella, huh?
Oh. So deep. Oh, is my internet not keeping up? Oh, there we go.
Yeah, I mean, okay. I'll show my cards here. I don't really mind the way she looks. She's just a cartoon character. But everything else about... Huh. This trailer. They got Crazy Steve, I think, from Drake and Josh.
I'm sorry if I'm just silent here. I'm just taking it all in.
Big cast.
Yeah, Rosa Salazar. I mean, that's a name that brings in the audiences. Ooh. Ooh. Ooh, no. No, that does not look like cool action.
No, she'll give you her heart.
Ooh, no. Bad. Bad. Directors should not have access to this...
To this technology.
Yeah. They just use it completely wrong. Battle Angel.
I like that. I'm glad it's not... Or wait, no, it is Alita Battle Angel. I want it to be Battle Angel Alita. God, that's so much better.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
What's wrong with people?
The action looks really cartoony and like I guess it is a Robert Rodriguez movie.
Can't believe it's Robert. They gave Robert Rodriguez $250 million.
I mean, he made the Spy Kids movies. Like, they owe him one. Those movies made a shit zillion dollars on like a fucking $20 million budget.
So why not just give him another $20 million budget? He does better with low budget. He does with the Grindhouse movies better when they look ridiculous. Why did they give him so much money? His movies are absolute schlock. Even though sometimes they're schlock on purpose, but still, man, jeez. He's just like, hey, I don't care.
Jennifer Connelly just looks like Jennifer Connelly in this, with like a little jewel on her forehead. So that's really distracting. I'm gonna pronounce his name right. Mahershala Ali is like, the market is totally saturated with him now. He's in fucking everything. Not that I don't think he's a great actor. Like, I really like his work, but he doesn't need to be in every goddamn thing that comes. Oh,
what has he been in? I don't know him.
He was in Moonlight. He was in House of Cards. Rest in peace, House of Cards.
Hashtag justice for Kevin. Justice for Kevin.
This is a bunch of stuff going out. Like, this action just looks so wrong.
Yeah, everyone's losing their mind over her eyes. I could not care less about her eyes.
This looks like video game. Like, this, you know when people say, like, this looks like a video game? This is the most of that I've ever seen. Like, this straight up looks like a cutscene in like
a Square Enix game.
Yeah.
But she just looks like a cartoon character. Yeah, I like the dialogue I'm more concerned about because it's awful. And the character design, like the mohawk lady and the spikes. And she says, I'll give you my heart, and that's the worst thing. The strong prey on the weak down here. No. No, please.
Christoph Waltz is holding a giant battle axe thing.
That could be worse. But the just...
I think James Cameron is involved in this. He's the producer. Isn't he producing?
Yes.
Yeah.
Strange.
Fuck it, Robert. Fuck it. Put as much money into this as you can.
Just ring the dingster again.
It's working out. Yes. Working out for me. It's worked out for me twice. Put all the money into it. People will see it. And no, I don't think they will, James. I don't think they will see this weird adaptation.
Why would you have Robert Rodriguez make a movie?
Semi-obscure manga.
Just, this is not Robert Rodriguez's wheelhouse at all. Oof. Boy,
I wonder if he wanted to do the Guillermo del Toro thing, maybe he wants to go for auteurship, and like he's like, oh yeah, you can give me complete control and I can make it happen. But like there's like the final shot of her falling, like jumping, you know, into this crater or whatever, and like and sliding down herself. That's a video game.
Lame. Video game shit. There's nothing happens. She's got Uggs and she just slides.
She stares
down.
Off into the distance, and that's very very. Very Final Fantasy.
The only shot I like is when she grabs the dude and slams his head into the table because it's very unnaturally fast, like it's very robotic, and that's kind of okay. Everything else is just way, it's like very boring, it's too flashy.
He should have made a Cyber City Oedo adaptation.
Sure, I don't know if he can do that gritty.
He can get that grit.
Everything he does is just too silly. Cyber City Oedo is very... serious property. Should be treated with the utmost respect.
They should do okay. Give one to Quentin Tarantino, give one to Robert Rodriguez, and give one to Guillermo del Toro, and let them each make one of the sections of Cyber City Oedo.
Oh.
Done. Hmm. Done and done. Okay. Who should get which one? I want Del Toro to get the one with vampires. Robert Rodriguez gets the one with the robot.
The one with the robot is way too cool. You can't give it to Robert Rodriguez. It'll be silly.
He needs to make it. He needs to grindhouse the fuck out of it. Like, I want a grindhouse version of that robot.
But also high budget, because it needs to look rad as fuck.
Well, I just want really, really huge film grain over top of it looking rad as fuck.
Yes. That's also I imagine it. Yeah, that's funny.
Yeah. like, that would look sick. You know what I mean?
Yes.
And then, you know, Tarantino takes the first one, which I forget about.
It's the skeleton... It's like a ghost is a skeleton. It's taken over a building, and it's fucking dudes up. And that would be good for him. It's nice and gory, right? Building
sold.
Yeah,
sold.
Yeah, and then Del Toro.
Maybe not this.
You could do other directors. Yeah, I don't know. Not this is. I've not read Battle Angel Alita. But
I'll get back to you.
Apparently, it's pretty good.
I am
classic.
I recently purchased a Junji Ito compilation. Ooh. You know, horror physical? Mangaka. Yeah, yeah, yeah. It was like $20 and it's like 9 short stories, which is like the exact amount of Junji Ito I want.
Sure.
Where yeah. I don't want to like invest myself in a solid 150 pages of right. gross disgustingness, like mm-hmm. Just gore and
yeah.
horrible imagery, but like I want to be able to get in and out of a different story, you know what I mean? I don't want to commit to one type of grossness. And then I was intending to have seen Kimi no Na wa by the time recorded this. Yeah, I have a big old 4K of it I'm going to watch because they came out on Ultra HD, and I will come back with results on how that worked out.
It's good.
Yeah, I'll let you know what I think of it, man.
Okay, you're going to think it's good.
Probably. I mean, it's probably just going to be more of the same from him.
Oh, yeah. You've seen his other works.
Yes.
I guess that was my first Makoto Shinkai. That's him, right?
You haven't seen 5 centimeters per second?
No.
Oh, shit.
It sounds like a bummer.
No, it's not. Oh, okay. No, it's fine. Nah, it's like life itself. It has its ups and downs, you know. It's
okay.
It's not just
also, it's like tone. 50 minutes.
Did you see the new Death Stranding trailer?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh my gosh.
I can't. I don't. It's
what is it?
It's nonsense.
What could the game be?
Kojima can never, he's never been able to capture my interest because I know there's nothing going on under the hood. I know it's just nonsense, which is why.
Oh, but it's really cool looking nonsense.
Sometimes, but sometimes it's just nonsense.
I think my biggest complaint with this trailer is that Homeboy's face is basically stoic the entire time, and he doesn't emote at all.
Well, yeah.
At any point,
you know.
But it's a Kojima game, so you can't anticipate that much emotion or emoting.
It's just like I don't care. But now the baby's in the no. I don't care.
I'm into it.
Like
I'm into it.
You can make up a. Oh, and then there's a block of cheese that you throw at the monster.
Nah, you lost me. You lost me. you know what it's going to be is you're going to get into a box and it'll be a sexy lady box, and then it'll distract the monster. And then you get out of it, and then you drink a Red Bull, and then you slam a fucking bag of Doritos, and then you cry.
Whatever, man.
Featuring Axe body spray.
Hideo Kojima is he's not even crazy. He just thinks he is. Everyone thinks he is, but he's just a guy trying really hard to make stuff that makes people go, whoa.
He's got really cool images in his stuff.
No, but, like, not really.
They're pretty. It's pretty cool imagery. It's pretty cool looking.
Like,
I'm
the shot
it.
Of him staring out at the crater and the floaty dudes. Like, that's one cool thing. And everything else is just fucktardery. With the baby in the jar.
But it's worth it.
And the whale. There's always got to be a whale. I don't need the whale.
I'm ready. I'm sold on whatever.
I bet it's... I wonder, yeah.
What could the game be, though? Like, what could the game even be?
They're trying to put it out in 2018, so it's not going to be very ambitious. It's probably going to be a lot... probably going to be somewhat stripped down compared to, like, a Metal Gear game. It's either going to be straight action or, like, straight stealth. Or, you know, a slight marriaging of the two.
Uh-huh.
Marriaging.
Perhaps some marriage. Some tactical... espionage action.
I don't know if there's gonna be much espionage. You don't seem like a spy type.
Well, no, I was quoting the Metal Gear subtitle.
Well, yeah, but I don't know.
But yeah, whatever it is, I'm sure it'll be better than fucking Fractale. Fuck.
Even,
that's it.
Even Battle Angel Elite is gonna be better than Fractale.
Oh god, Robert Rodriguez should make an adaptation of Fractale.
Robert Rodriguez should stop making things. Did he direct? Machete 2?
Yeah.
That shit was balls.
No.
It just sucked.
Nah, man.
Come on, man.
I've seen way worse. It's a 5. I've seen way worse.
It was not good.
It's a 5.
Yeah, whatever.
You have a machete. I feel like he's gotten old, and in not in like the way that like Guillermo del Toro like really matured as a filmmaker, but I think for the longest time Robert Rodriguez was still trying to make the movies he made when he was young, and like you know, just wanted to make like cool action shit, you know, like and
he was reaching when did he ever way make of cool action shit.
Desperado and you know, like El Mariachi and shit like that, you know, like just westerns, you know, and like he was reaching way above, he was like super ambitious, and he had to, you know, find ways to make it on a lower budget, and that was fucking super ill, and he was a scrappy young filmmaker, and now he has unlimited money and is still trying to make those, and it loses the charm because he has unlimited money. And but in like Guillermo del Toro, you know, started out in a similar situation and isn't reaching to make those same horror movies that he made when he was younger. Like he just started thinking way, way more grand in like Pan's Labyrinth, obviously fucking masterpiece. Shape of Water is probably going to be real good. You know, like that's like Crimson Peak is like, it's a horror movie, but it's a Victorian horror, like theatrical epic basically. And it is so, it, you know, you can trace like the origins of back to early in his career, but he's reaching so for something so far beyond that, you know what I mean, beyond what he was initially doing. Anyways,
it's too bad Robert Pacific Rim stinks.
The original one,
yeah. Did the second one come out yet?
You didn't like the first Pacific Rim? Oh, it's no. Totally fine. Nah. It's totally fine.
No characters.
It's totally fine.
Action's boring.
It's got so much. They got weight though. Yeah, the character, the robot's got weight and momentum.
I don't fucking care. It's CG. It's not impressive.
No, but like, but like, everybody uses like, CG.
It's not like weight the cool way, like in End of Evangelion. It's just like they go slow. That's it.
We'll disagree. All right. I think using a battleship as a baseball bat is cool.
Yeah, see.
I didn't say it was a masterpiece. Like it's fun, rah rah, kill the monster.
There was like one thing I thought was cool in that movie, and that's when he's in the sky and he takes out the knife, and everything else is just like eh.
What about how they skip to like the next level of kaiju?
But no, they don't. They go from 4 to 5.
I thought they were anticipating 4, and then it ends up being a 5.
No, that was our idea.
Oh, fuck, really? I have to watch Pacific Rim.
That was our idea, because they're dealing with 4s the whole movie, and then it's like, that's a category 5, and then we were like, after the movie, we were like, they totally should have just skipped to 6.
No, fuck that. It should have, category 8. It's infinite category. Yeah, that becomes, it transcends.
It's totally arbitrary. It's like, this thing's a singularity.
We can't even classify it. Its levels are off the charts.
Yeah.
And the charts, like, you know, you have waveforms that are determining its power level, and they're just like rainbow colored and shit. You know, like when you go you go below the plug depth in Evangelion, and it all starts becoming like crazy trippy psychedelia.
Right.
Like it's like it should be like that, but
it should have been that instead of the guy from It's Always Sunny just going, whoa, I'm getting electrocuted. Whoa.
They really should have.
I'm an Asian lady. I know kung fu. I'm gonna be boring.
They it should have been irradiating pure energy. Like it should have just been giving off rainbow colors, and
warping space and time around its body.
Yeah. See, like Pokemon does that. Like Pokemon's got that shit.
You still watching that Pokemon?
No. I'm saying, like the Pokemon games, if you go fight something that is like the ruler of space and time, the world's gonna be warping. You go into like a dark realm. You know what I mean? Like even Pokemon's got that shit figured out. But it should be blinding. It should be complete. Like they should have been blinded by the sheer magnificence of.
They should be weeping and doing the sign of the cross.
See, like, that's how... Oh, fuck. Give us Pacific Rim 3.
I'm telling you, yeah. See, Pacific Rim could have been so much better.
Pacific Rim is fine, but it's like, I mean...
If you're gonna do, like, you know, please the crowd hype shit, like, oh, look, he's swinging an aircraft carrier. Isn't that so rad and epic, my fellow Redditors? Then just we're coming up with so much better shit right off our mind.
Well, you can't do that in the first movie, and you gotta build up to it. You got like
you build up to it in the third.
Ethan Hawke isn't fucking ripping off four masks in the first Mission Impossible movie, or Ethan Hunt rather. He's doing that in the second movie because that's like the good one. You know what I mean? Like you gotta establish the paradigm, and then you can start shaking shit up by getting completely off the wall with it.
Save the good stuff for the second movie. That always works out.
That's worked with Spider-Man.
Yeah, that first one's fine.
Yeah, but then they decided to just make. What is Pacific Rim 2 even?
Is that movie out yet? I asked that before.
Wait, they seem like they're throwing that one out there to die, huh?
Well, yeah, it looks terrible.
Well, but like. Pacific Rim Uprising.
Oh, yeah.
Like, why is it an uprising?
March 23rd. I feel like the marketing hit its peak like this summer. Why is it March 23rd?
Is there a revolution or something?
Maybe it's the monsters that are uprising, man.
It's been 10 years since Battle of Breach.
A new generation of Jaeger pilots. It's directed by Stephen S. DeKnight.
Wasn't this the last movie? Wasn't the last movie a new generation of...
No, of, it was like the Jaeger. First one.
Well, No. Because the homeboy was like a member of like the previous... He and his brother were pilots together, and then they bought it, and then it was like there was a time skip, and then there were new pilots. You know what I mean?
Whatever. I don't know. I saw that movie 8 years ago. When did that movie come out, actually? Was that 2014?
2013.
2013. What? My life...
Pacific Rim Uprising is a springboard for a cinematic universe, apparently. So
Scott Eastwood's in this one. Our hero. Savior of the Aryan race.
I think, apparently, this might cross over with the Monsterverse. We'll see how that pans out.
What's the monster? Oh, no.
That's Godzuki. That's Godzuki and Ken Kong.
Oh, not the... Okay, not the...
No, not the Universal Monsterverse.
Right, yeah, I was going to say.
That'd be way better.
Is Dracula going to be in this?
Oh.
What is Stephen S. DeKnight directed? Daredevil. Okay. Spartacus.
Do we ever talk about Kong Skull Island? Do we talk about that? I think we might have talked about that, but like...
Maybe. I don't remember much about it.
It's so mediocre.
It was...
It's so easy to tune out and not like pay attention to it at all.
I remember it being... Yeah, we talked a lot throughout it, but I remember it being kind of entertaining.
It's schlocky.
Surprise John C. Reilly was fun, and he's like a...
John C. Reilly's a good actor. I'll say he's good and stuff. He's fucking awesome in Boogie Nights. Like, he's good in movies. He's a good actor.
And he's like a hobo leading these indigenous people on this island, just hanging out, and that's cool. And Samuel L. Jackson being crazy military guy.
Holy shit. Okay, you know, hold on.
And there are some ridiculous shots in that movie. I can't remember them, but I remember the fact that they are ridiculous. So, I don't know.
Okay, here are the influences on Kong Skull Island.
Influences?
Take this with a grain of salt. Like, this is from the director. This is straight from the horse's
mouth. Okay.
Okay, obviously Apocalypse Now, duh. Platoon, duh. South Korean film, The Host.
Okay.
The entire Neon Genesis Evangelion series.
Wow. All right.
Princess Mononoke.
Wait, what?
Cubone from Pokemon.
Wait. Just the Cubone?
Yeah. And Satchel from Evangelion, even though he called out all of Evangelion already. This is Voight Roberts.
What the fuck is this guy on?
I don't see the Evangelion at all. I do see... Look at his beard!
I just clicked on his picture. Oh my god, he looks like fucking, oh my god. What's the act... What's... I'm not here.
Oh god, Joaquin Phoenix.
Why he looks like Joaquin Phoenix in his fake documentary.
You mean I'm still not here?
I'm still not here.
Whatever. I am no longer not here.
I'm not here anymore. Oh, he directed The Kings of Summer. I've been wanting to watch that. I need to absorb every coming-of-age story I can. I missed out on childhood.
I also would like to watch Kings of Summer.
Oh, you've heard about that, too.
I've been meaning to watch it. Yes.
Successful alcoholics.
Whoa! He's tapped to direct This
Metal Gear Solid. Yeah, no.
Yeah, not very made. I'm like, oh no.
Yeah, the exact same.
That
reaction.
Shit'll never be made.
No video game movie ever gets made. But yeah.
I guess we don't know anymore that anything can get made now.
Who knows?
Battle Angel Alita is getting made.
Man, as much as like Metal Gear Solid never connected with me as much as most people, that will never come through in film. that can't happen. They can't do that in a mainstream movie.
I am 100% willing to give it a shot. If somebody gave me $200 million to make a Metal Gear Solid movie, Metal Gear the fuck out of that movie.
No, that committee would, you wouldn't, they would reshoot it and you'd be fucked.
Oh man, dude, Joss Whedon would be brought in. Joss Whedon would be.
Yeah. We can't have the snake character talk like this.
What do you mean? I'm playing Snake.
Oh yeah.
I would cast myself as Snake.
No, you know what? That should be Scott Eastwood, because he's not a great actor. He's pretty robotic, and he would just tell him to talk like this the whole time. You could teach him that pretty easily. You could train him.
I mean, why don't we just go get Snake Plissken? You know what I mean? Like it's not too late. What?
He's too old.
Shut your mouth.
He's too old.
Kurt Russell, he's only 66.
He just looks old. He can't even make it out with Meryl. He's too old.
Get over here, Meryl. And Meryl's like 19.
I mean, what if he's successful and you have to make 5 more movies over the course of the next 12 years?
Well, you skip right to 4. You skip right to Metal Gear Solid 4.
What about 2?
What?
That's important.
It's mostly riding anyway.
But that's when you establish the Patriots. You establish everything in 2. The speech about the internet, that's the most important speech in all of Metal Gear.
It
all comes true. Sort of, apparently, people think, but I don't really think.
I don't know. Who are actors that look like Kurt Russell? they're not
Scott
hard to
Eastwood
combine.
With a beard.
Actors who look like Kurt Russell. Look like Russell Crowe. No, close.
Russell Crowe would work. Yeah, I don't...
Kurt Russell totally looks like Jeff Bridges. Oh, good. We're going the wrong way.
That's true.
We're going the wrong direction here. Kurt Russell, Jeff Bridges.
Who looks like Kurt Russell? Patrick Swayze? He's dead.
Oh, yeah. We're going the wrong way. We need these guys to be with us.
Yeah, there's no one.
It's all old guys.
Yeah, see?
Everyone's very, very effeminate now. There's no true masculine actors anymore. And Scott Eastwood will never be. Scott Eastwood will never really be a leading man. So
he needs to get his break at some point. He could totally be Snake. Grow a beard. I'm telling you.
I know who I'm gonna tap. Taylor Kitsch, my boy. Dude, Otacon, bro.
You know what? Doesn't sound too bad. He could be Gray Fox.
Dude, Snake, bro.
We were comrades, bro.
I like the pain, bro. Oh, it hurts so good, dude. Whoa. I'm fucking...
He doesn't talk like... He was totally... He had a normal Southern Texas accent in Friday Night Lights.
Have you seen Friday Night Lights?
I watched a lot of Friday Night Lights.
Was it good?
My parents enjoyed it. It was kind of good. I mean, it was, you know, obviously it was a little ridiculous because it was so dramatic. This Texas football team, and you know, all the high school kids being played by 30-year-olds. But it was pretty good. It really was.
Yeah, it seemed like a decent show. I haven't caught any of it yet. I really like the coach in that. I think he's a great actor. I've seen him in a lot of shows.
I always forget
his name.
Yeah, he did a good job in that. His wife is good in that show.
You could not... I cannot, you're gonna immediately end this podcast as soon as I bring this up. I cannot fucking tell you how good the second season of Riverdale is. I cannot.
I don't know what you see in that show at all.
It's like the best in terms of like entertaining schlock. It's so much awesome melodrama, and it's got the boobs and there's so many, but sometimes they're in bras, and the girl, it's got the sexiest cast ever assembled for television, and like all of the twists are so. Archie starts a terrorist cell in Riverdale, and he records himself and uploads a YouTube of him talking about how he's gonna protect the city, and then he says that we're Legion, and it's awesome, it's so good, and then there's a gang fight, he gets in Archie's gang, fights another biker gang in the rain, it's super fast.